Well, wow. Yeah.
Welcome
This
back.
is Lewis. Thank you. Thank you. This is Lewis Brandmeier. That is Richard Futrell, and the slight laugh, giggle kind of thing you heard in the background was Tyler Brandmeier. We are Clever Orbits, and I am just at the McCarran International Airport in Las Vegas, finishing up with my first Star Trek Las Vegas. That is the biggest in the world convention, which was held here from August 1st until last night, August 5th. You can tell I got whatever amount of sleep I got. What we're doing here today is we're calling this In the Raw because there's so much. A 5-day experience is full of a lot of density of information, content, and processing, and appreciation, and discovery, not just the show, but actual discovering, which would have been a better word there, discovering. I'm here to have my good buddies interview me very briefly to see where I'm at and to share all of what's there and what I've experienced. So first of all, I know that you, Tyler, you've seen the live streams, right?
A few.
These are the famous live streams. Actually, you know what? I'm going to back up. Where I'm at with this whole thing is actually, it's really profound. The experience of being immersed in 5 days or 4 or 5 days with people who love what you do, and especially people who are committed to a world that works on some level, like when it comes to diversity and mutual respect of persons and compassion. It's just like basic willingness to do good by the other people that they interact with. Like that was, it was like a certain kind of utopia, with a lot of colors and lights and famous
So
actors.
do you think Star Trek is creating the very utopia that it sees within its own show?
Yes, I think so. We watched Far Beyond the Stars, which was directed and starred in by Avery Brooks, who sadly was not there this week. He doesn't like to come to conventions. Ira Stephen Baer, the creator of the show, said because he's very emotionally sensitive and to have to come to one of these things might be overwhelming for him, which makes sense to me because there's such a depth of heart that you get from his character. But in that episode, he's a black writer of science fiction stories in the 1950s, facing discrimination both from the police in authority figures, excuse me, in authority figures both like the police and like the owners of the newspaper that he is, or the pulp magazine that he's working for. And he has this idea, which is basically the idea of the series of Deep Space Nine. And so he is trying to present this and trying to get it published. And he's all excited because his editor says, "All right, we're going to do this." And then the owner of the pulp magazine says, "Yeah, no, we can't do this. It's too soon for a black man to have a science fiction story published and for people to know about that." So Benny Russell, Avery Brooks' character, returns to work after getting brutally beaten by the actors Jeffrey Combs and Mark Alamo, who play Gul Dukat. And, well, Jeffrey Combs plays everybody. That's Tyler's a nice joke. He's like on so many series. But they're playing detectives who are racist. And so he's been brutally beaten. He's coming back to work. He's kind of tender. And his direct editor says, "Hey, you know, I'm sorry, we couldn't publish your book, and your services are no longer required." And he looks at him, and he gives this amazing soliloquy, which I found out he actually had to deliver twice with full force and gusto, where he says, "Deep Space Nine exists. It is an idea, and you cannot kill an idea. This idea is here. It's real. I have experienced it." And he just breaks down. He actually has a heart attack at that point. And then as he's like being carted off, this priest who is played by I believe Brock Peters, who is the actor that plays his father, says to him, "You are the dreamer and the dream." And so like there was this moment when I was like, "That's it. That is what we are here doing when we are feeding in our imagination this vision." And there's a whole lot that I could go into around neuroscience and around metaphysics of what is happening when we're feeding a vision, when we're living in the vision of a future, either in our imagination or yeah, even just in our imagination. But we'll save that, and I'll merely say that the utopia itself was present. The possibility of Star Trek was present. The possibility of a world that works for everyone, no one and nothing left out, which is what I said to Shaniqua Martin Green when I got up in front of the microphone. I said, hey, you know, I applaud and appreciate you and the entire cast of Discovery because you guys coming into this, you are acutely conscious and conscientious of the sensitive nature of what you're doing. You're contributing to a community that's thousands and thousands and thousands of people strong, and you're contributing to this profound literary vehicle for the transformation of the world that has so far contributed all this to science and technology and culture and art and the hope of diversity and the mutual respect and equal treatment of women and people of different races. And, like, I mean, on one of my live streams, I said this. There was just this guy in a chair, right? He was obviously sick. And I don't know what kind of degenerative disease he had or whatever, but it was me and this other guy dressed as Starfleet officers in the elevator. And I might, fair warning, I might tear up at this. His caretaker who was with him was having trouble getting the chair to work. It kept turning off, and they kept trying to move it out of the elevator. And she was getting a little frantic. She was, like, afraid of the impact that it was having on me and this guy. And he and I looked at each other, and there was nothing there for us. There was just like, what can we do? How can we help? And what I got was, that's not how it is everywhere. That's not how it is everywhere in the world for someone with a disability, or especially someone who's just different than you. Judgment and stories get in the way of the basic nourishing human need for and predilection for connection and empathy, but not in that moment, not in that moment. And that's what I got, is that we're here together to build that and to stand for that and to represent that and to explore that and to enjoy the nuance and the detail of artworks that illustrate that. And I you know, immediately after I left the elevator, after his caretaker was able to get him off of the elevator, I went back to my room and I started weeping because I was like, that, it's so subtle and it's so profound. It's the same thing as having a woman in authority and respected and not, like, belittled, right? With Kate Mulgrew playing Captain Janeway, or a black man playing the captain of a space, or a you know, a Scotsman existing next to an Asian man and a black woman and a Southern boy on the bridge of the original Enterprise. Like, it's so subtle that we don't even notice what it's doing for us. But it's providing us a vision of a world where things are as they should be. People are treated the way they should be. And that like, the importance of this thing, it goes so much far beyond us, and so much farther beyond, like, oh, this is fun and interesting and entertaining. Like this is really a vehicle for social change and transformation of the world. And, yeah, so in answer to your question, Richard, sorry, I waxed pretty deep on that, but I have a strong, serious, hardcore, deep-rooted belief and stand that what this thing is and what this thing is for, it's for making the world a better place. And I had the experience of that at the convention. People were committed to connecting. And that was actually the biggest value. Whenever I'd ask people, like, what did you love most about being here? They'd say the connection. And there's nothing like the experience of that. I've never had an experience of that in my whole life, anywhere, relative to anything. Talk about landmark, talk about retreats that I went on when I was Catholic or Christian, or retreats more recently, like campouts or whatever, where the whole purpose is to, like, cultivate connection and relationship. Nothing more powerful and more profound and more pervasive than the experience that I had at this convention of just, like, we're all instantly friends. We all instantly respect each other. We all have appreciation and enjoyment for the care and attention and craft that's been put into the creation of cosplay outfits, and the unique views and perspectives that each person has on each episode or series or actor or piece of memorabilia or whatever. Like, it was a certain type of heaven, and I put on the unofficial Las Vegas Facebook convention group. I said it was like waking into Christmas Day 5 days in a row, and you know, the fact that I was able to speak in front of 2,500 people and share about this podcast, or share about my coaching, or share about how, you know, one day last year, my coaching for one of our mutual friends was, hey man, you're dealing with this alcoholism and you're dealing with this alienation. Like, the best thing for you is to come on my podcast. And like, I know that he was dealing with suicidal depression. And that was what Shaniqua was moved by, because she knew that her producing that show gave us a reason to podcast, and us having a podcast gave him a reason not to stew in his own emotional chaos for just an hour or two. Even if he was drunk, he still had a community to come to. And so that what I experienced, and actually when I stood up in my fully next to my fully packed bags in my suite at the Rio All Suites Hotel Casino, I looked around and I said, it's been an honor. I said, it's been an honor. Why? Because, not because it was fun, and it was. Not because it was entertaining, and it was. Not because it was the most interesting and delicious sense of like community and family instantly afforded to a person participating that I've ever experienced. No, it was an honor because I am there to leave my impress and my mark on, and to empower and uplift the people in that community with every fiber of my being. To serve is the honor. So, yeah, I know this. This has been mostly, what is it Picard says? I'm beginning to give a speech.
This is becoming a speech.
This is
you're
the
captain,
where you're supposed
you're
to
entitled.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So, yeah, that's just the picture painted in very broad strokes, right? That's the, like, rigorous, burning, bleeding heart of my experience of this convention. And there's so many fine details, so many fine people that deserve specific acknowledgement, just for their generosity of spirit and openness and conversation and connection. We don't have all that time right now while I'm waiting for my flight or preparing for my flight. So, I'll just make passing reference to the fact that we're going to do a more in-depth podcast probably next week on this. For the time being, I'll just reference you guys to my Facebook live stream on my Facebook wall. And if you aren't my friend yet, then for the love of Jakar, oops, wrong franchise, become my friend on Facebook. Send me a request, because if you're in the sound of my voice and you have any interest in Star Trek or conventions, I would love to share my experiences with you. There's some great live streams. I feel like maybe we should save the fine detail of those, because there's a lot of discussion to have around who is William Shatner, like, really? Like, what kind of joker is that man?
Tell us briefly about the encounters and connections you made with the Star Trek stars and people that created it.
Man, oh, so I met Anson Mount. I met Phil Morris. I met Dominic Keating. I met Dominic Keating, Connor Trenier, Anthony Montgomery, Garrett Wang, William Shatner, Kate Mulgrew, Jonathan Frakes, Emily Kootz. She was the only one I got an autograph from, which is, there's a funny story behind that, but it may never actually reach airtime. There was, you know, that first moment, I'm trying to remember who the first one that I saw was. It must have been Wednesday or Thursday. I think it was Garrett Wang. I really think it was Garrett Wang. Who I saw, and I was just like, you know, floored, because you're someone I only know from television, and you're real, and you're here, and you're in front of me. Oh my God! And I had a conversation with him. He's a nice, he's a real sweet guy. He actually sells Captain Proton T-shirts.
Nice.
And technically, he is the first person to say yes to being on our podcast. And I am not ashamed to say that our podcast is a work in progress, and we did not have business cards for this trip. So he actually asked me for a business card, and I was like, we certainly will have business cards and I think a booth next year, because that's the way to do it, like to really engage with the fans and serve them. I think of the people that I met, Tyler, you'll love this. Doug Jones actually gave me a very, like, paternal, kind of loving, compassionate kiss. It was at one and the same time strange and like very much reassuring and like comforting, like a family member. You know how we kiss each other on the forehead, Tyler?
Of course.
Yeah, we're maybe different from the male heteronormative stereotype in expressing our love for one another in that way. And he kind of after I shared what I shared in front of him and the other people on the Discovery panel on Sunday, like, when I ran into him in the vendor's room later, he came up to me. Like, I could tell. I could see he was interacting with somebody else. He caught me. He caught my eye, and I caught his. And I could see the wheel turning in his head. He had committed in that moment, I have to talk to him. Like, I have to say hello again. So he finished talking to whoever it was, and he came over. And he looked me up and down, and he said, "Don't ever change. And thank you so much." And then he gave me like, it was a very gentle kiss. And I don't think there was any hint of, like, homosexuality or anything to it. There was just this very pure energy of love and appreciation. And, like you'll see in the Shaniqua live stream, her part of the live stream, she says it's or actually, I haven't put that up yet. I think I'm going to put that up soon. I only have the video for that. You can find pretty much all the videos for all the panels or all the major panels on a YouTube channel produced by a really cool friend of mine who I met at the conference or convention, and I also recorded lots of live streams with her. Her name is Heather Ferris, F-E-R-R-I-S, like Timothy Ferris, which is not, you know, too far a comparison, because she's just a machine of awesome. Her commitment is to provide access to an experience of the convention for those who can't be there, those who can't, you know, afford it or make it this year or make it to all of it for whatever reason. And you get a really powerful vicarious experience of the convention through these panels and through her walking around, interviewing fans, looking at cosplay outfits, taking you to different rooms. And I was your co-host and co-star for a number of those live streams. It was actually really fun to connect with her and to give to the community in the way that she does. She's got a heart of gold. She, I am almost certain, has the Discovery Sunday panel with Shaniqua Martin Green, Doug Jones, Anson Mount up on YouTube, or she will have it soon. And if she doesn't, we'll publish video that I had. Christina, who was standing behind me in line at the front of the room and recorded my entire conversation with the Discovery cast. So we'll have that up soon. But it was really refreshing to interact with all these people. And what I was amazed by and interested in was, like, when they're not, so there were three tiers of actors. There's the biggest names, like William Shatner, Patrick Stewart, who was there this weekend to make the big announcement about the new series, and, Shaniqua Martin Green or whatever. And it's kind of harder to access them or to engage with them because, like, they have their own panel, and that's the place to do it if you're ballsy and you're bold and you're willing to stand in front of 2,500 people and ask a question or share what's going on for you. So that you can have a I treated it as basically having a conversation with these big names in front of other people in a way that hopefully serves and honors these other people, you know? I didn't have much trouble accessing them, but there's the first tier, and the huge, huge lines, dozens of people deep, going for hundreds and hundreds of feet to get to the table just to have them take 5 to 10 seconds signing an autograph for you. And then there's the second level, like the ones who weren't really the protagonists but were part of the main supporting cast, like Dominic Keating, Connor Trenier, Gary Graham, J.G. Hertzler. They were, a lot of the time at vendor tables in the vendor room signing autographs and just sitting there and you know, chumming around with fans, which was super cool. And then you get those kind of third-tier actors, which I have every amount of respect and love for the work that these people do. And this distinction may actually be incorrect, like, because I haven't read the IMDb pages of all these people. So to any of you who are listening, I love and appreciate the work that you have done, and I honor you, and I vote your victory in finding and creating all the work you do want. But there was a sense of, like, these actors who were only maybe on one episode of the show, kind of like Guy from Galaxy Quest. He's like, "I'm just jazzed that I was on the show, man." And so they're, like, doing their best to capitalize on that. Like, actors who I don't remember playing characters who I don't remember. And I've watched all of the Star Trek in the past, you know, 2 to 3 years. So if anybody should remember who these people are, I probably should. And it takes something to jog one's memory, even for the one who played the love interest and the cetacean biologist from Star Trek IV. She was there. I forget her name. But it took a second for me to jog my memory with her. So it was pretty delightful, actually, because these are people who interface with the franchise in very unique ways, each into themselves. You get William Shatner, who well, we could do a whole podcast on that man, but who I experienced as more of a showman and an entertainer than as someone willing to engage on a visceral heart level with me.
That
in
seems
front of
accurate.
The room. What's that?
That seems accurate.
Yeah, yeah. And then there was Kate Mulgrew, who had a profound appreciation for the impact that she had and has, and a very shrewd, sharp appreciation for the intellectual aspects of Star Trek, like what it's doing and what kinds of conversations it sparks. And like she on some level is Janeway. Like on some level, to some extent, that character is just part of her that got expressed and that got like rigorously defined and concretized and exercised through the role of the captain. Because, you know, when I was on stage talking to her, there was such a sensitivity and such a precision and an attentiveness and also a warmth. Like a loving kind of warmth to her engagement. And then, oh, man, I've got nothing but absolutely love and adoration and good things to say about Shaniqua Martin-Green because, you know, of what she said when we were engaging and because of her response. I've seen this in interviews. There was an interview maybe a year ago, maybe even, where she got on and she was talking about, like, her consciousness of being the first black woman to helm and protagonist a Star Trek series, and she broke down into tears because she knows that there are people who are suffering because of lack of representation in the world now that she is mitigating against through her portrayal. And it's kind of, when I went to, this is actually really great, one of the vendors' tables, it was called Gaze in Space, and it can actually only be pronounced that way because there are three A's in both gaze and space, so if you're an ally of LGBTQ, that would be a place to look on Facebook, is spelled with three A's and three A's, respectively. Good people, good people. When I was talking to him, he was inviting me out to a party with, where Anthony Rapp was going to be, and was at the Piranha. I didn't make it out. I really wanted to because they were giving out disco shirts. Richard, you love this. The disco shirts, instead of an O, it had a disco ball, and on the back it said Burry. V-E-R-Y. So it was what we thought they should always be, a disco Burry shirt. Anyway, he was saying the best way to support that whole realm of existence and that sector of people is to just not have it be a thing, that they are different, to not have it be a thing. And that's the biggest thing about this show and about the, you know, Janeway being the first woman, Shaniqua being the first black woman, Avery Brooks being the first black man, you know, is that in the context of the show, the characters treat it as not a thing. It's not something to resist or be upset about or make mean anything because it's accepted as the normal that these people deserve equal rights and respect and attention and discriminated against. And so anyway, that's my engagement with the actors was nothing but fulfilling and satisfying. I guess I could have just said that. Next question. Thank you very much.
Got anything, Tyler?
How did it feel to actually be roasted by William Shatner?
We got sexy airport phone voice going on, so I'm going to give her the space that she needs. I wonder who it was, the person they got to do this. She seemed chipper, which is strange considering the job that she must do. Okay, so it was Tyler. You know what's funny is considering the fact that the next day I saw and got to like really reconnect with my father, like my biological father for the first time in 27 years, which was epic and amazing and beautiful and wondrous in all the ways that you can imagine and some of those that you can't. I actually connected with my father first on stage with him. And what I mean by that is part of me always looked up to him as a role model and always, like, had a kind of trust in his ability to generously handle and lovingly treat those who want to be connected with him. Like, there was just a faith, a basic faith in that, maybe based on a confabulation from the parasocial relationship of me, like, seeing Captain Kirk and thinking, oh, he's such a good guy. And not knowing William Shatner really is not Captain Kirk. Captain Kirk is part of William Shatner that he switches on sometimes. So my experience of him was I mean, so being roasted by William Shatner, right? That was an empowering context that somebody else at the con gave me. Like, literally in the moment, what happened was I shut down. So in Landmark, one of the things we distinguish is aspects of personality or psychology that have us relate to the world to help us survive and to be okay. And one of mine is what they call the trump card of confusion. So when something is too painful for me to face or to be with, I get confused, or something is too confronting for me to acknowledge about myself or about the world that I live in or whatever. And 100%, I think that's what happened, was I had a simple question that I was wanting to ask an actor about his craft as a professional, and what showed up was him trying to AMOG me. It was a term from pickup artistry where you're in a group and you're trying to show off to the women in the room, so you have to cut down another man. And that was my experience, actually, was from the first moment he pretended like I had asked a question before I had and asked if that was a good enough answer when he had just chosen to talk about whatever the heck he wanted to talk about. And then all throughout me trying to articulate my appreciation and acknowledgement of him for introducing me to philosophy and space science and women, like I started making out with a woman in daycare because I saw him do it on the screen. And I've had a lifelong adoration and appreciation for the fairer sex, so to speak, no offense, feminist. Dating, relationships, love, romance, and sex, that all was sprouted from the seed planted there in that moment when I saw him on that screen. And, like, that is one of the biggest elements of my personality and my commitment in the world, is to, like, relate to those things in an intriguing, interesting, empowering way and to help others do the same. And so, like, there was this deep, heartfelt, like, whole life personal acknowledgement that I was trying to deliver to him. And he just switched into reaction mode and domination. And, like, hey, I need everybody's attention to be on me, and I'm here to entertain them, and I'm going to make fun of you and make you feel like a sexual deviant and a pervert. And or I'm going to try to add those meanings to you. And, in fact, I'm going to completely sidestep your question. Now, I say all of this with no resentment and no disrespect, right? I talked to my friend Tim. He's from Southern California. And I was saying, man, you know, my experience of William Shatner, especially at the end, I didn't finish that. So what happened was I was deeply hurt. I was deeply saddened. I actually was so impacted that this shroud of confusion descended upon me. And I was not able to be in touch with what was actually going on for me in my body or in my gut. Like it just wasn't there until later on in the evening. I got on the phone with Hero, my girlfriend, and it came clear to me. I was like, oh, the one who I've looked up to as a father figure made fun of me in front of 2,500 people. And he sidestepped my question, and he didn't dignify the fact that he's made a huge impact on my life for the good. He just didn't listen. And that hurt. And so it took like 30 minutes of bitter tears. Honestly, before I had moved through that and was able to put together some of the material I had gathered throughout the day, which was like, there was this period where I was just confused, and I kind of was interviewing people around me who were in the room. I was like, so what actually happened? I'm not even sure what happened. I'm kind of confused about what he said. And one of them said, oh, yeah, you were roasted by William Shatner, and that's the story of a lifetime. And I was like, yeah, that sounds good. We'll go with that. And then later on, you know, I was in line. I was really committed to inviting him on this podcast, actually, and getting his autograph and, like, having him pick his favorite episode. You know, maybe someday we'll still do that. But I was in line. I told my mom. I shared with my mom the live stream, and I said, you know, I feel like I missed something in this interaction. I feel like it was an Asperger's moment. Like, I feel like something he said didn't make sense to me, or I maybe misconstrued what he said, or didn't state things properly. I wasn't responsible enough for my communication, or on some level, because I was just left with the feeling of like confusion and vague confusion. Like it was indiscernible for me. And she responded, "No, that man is an asshole. That man is a narcissist." and she got all like an angry cat. She was like, "No, son, you are not fucked up. You are not messed up. You didn't miss anything. He was just mean to you." Nice. And there was this this redemptive line at the end where he says, hey, you know, all of what I did on the screen was fantasy. And you can sort of hear it in the live stream. I said, you know, it's funny because that led to many happy realities. So, like, it was funny because, like, I was struggling just to acknowledge him and appreciate him for what he had done in my life. And he wasn't able to be with that. He was on his own trip. And he's 80-plus years old. He's set in his ways. And this is a balancing piece. So Tim told me, hey, you know, some people get that from him. He's a consummate entertainer, and he's got a huge ego. And other people at the con said, yeah, he's in it for the buck. Like, on some level, all of what he does, he's in it for the buck. And, you know, I don't know him. I haven't talked to him. But what he didn't do is what I'm committed to doing, which is taking the time and having the patience and the consideration to understand where he's coming from fully, to listen to him fully in what he's saying and where he's coming from, which, you know, I didn't have the experience of him doing from the stage with me. He wasn't willing to dignify the fact that, yes, some people are sexual at age 7. There's nothing wrong with that. We don't need you to look – he doesn't need to look good and get society's approval by judging someone for being sexual for earlier than I don't know, 12 years old watching porn that you shouldn't see made by crappy people in South California trying to make a buck off of – well, anyway, that's a long story. This is a political conversation suddenly. I'm turning that knob down. Yeah, so, I mean, I love him still, which is, you know, the moment where he says, oh, you're a masochist, right? And I respect him and his work, but so to answer your question, Richard, at first it was confusing, and then it was disorienting, and then it allowed me to like really get in touch with community and figure out like, all right, who is this guy, and how do you see him, and how do you relate to him, and then after that it was pain and sadness, and then eventually, finally, deep, considerate, compassionate understanding and appreciation for like, hey, he's a human, and he's also a machine, so probably something autopilot got triggered in his behavioral repertoire, and he wasn't able to be fully present. And that's all of us, right? That's all of us. We've all got unique triggers that do that to us and unique past experiences that we haven't gotten out of our system yet that we're still reacting to every day. And that's, you know, part of what I'm committed to freeing people from. But it takes work, and not everybody's able to do the work, privy to the fact that work can be done, or willing to do that kind of work when they're aware that it's possible. And so, like, you know, that's a big thing. But, yeah, I mean, in retrospect, it was a profoundly telling moment for me in what I learned. So what I already distinguished for you guys, that this is a community that is built in utopia through our imagination and the way we treat each other now. And when someone gets on stage and is not highly sensitive to the impact that their communications have on another person, and they leave me the way that he left me, that's something to call out and to be a little bit upset about in a way that doesn't make him wrong, but that draws to his and everyone else's attention the opportunity that was missed, which was to treat me the way that, you know, that we treat all of the characters and all of the people in that community, the disabled ones, the autistic ones, the colorful ones, the weird-looking ones. This is a place where people can go, and I have to tell this story. I was at the Trekdom panel. So it's about the history of Trekdom, like Trek fandom. And this woman from Britain gets up and says, hey, and she starts crying. She says, you know, for 300 days a year, maybe 360 or whatever, my life is just shit. It is crap. And if you guys can mute yourselves while I'm talking, there's like banging in the background. But and she says, hey, you know, but I come here and people, I can... If my bag gets lost, I can trust that somebody will bring it to Lost and Found. If you're in a wheelchair, someone will open the door for you. And, you know, if you have a differing opinion, people will stop and listen and give you a moment to talk. And how profoundly different and distinct that is, that the experience of that, from her daily life. And so I was really moved by that. And I was like, yeah, you know, that's true. That's it. That's this. And that's it's an ideal, right? Not everybody there, not all of the time. Expresses or embodies this. And the highlighting of the fact that there is an ideal or there is an opportunity to honor an ideal, Starfleet officer or a Federation citizen, so to speak, whatever, like that is where aesthetics becomes ethics, where aesthetics becomes politics, and where the sometimes chaotic, painful, suffering-filled world that we live in becomes something filled with hope and excitement and curiosity and wonder and joy and connection and thrill. So this is my like meta philosophy on Star Trek. This is what I see when I look at this show now, and I would not have seen it this way were it not for this weekend. So yeah, thanks for asking.
Oh, that's a very powerful sentiment.
What else do you guys want to know?
Appreciated every moment of that. We were not disappointed by the answer to that question.
It was Tyler's question.
Yes, thank you, Tyler. And, you know, okay, if it were a slightly different context, I might have had fun being roasted by William Shatner. But not this time. Maybe next time.
I get that. Yeah, perhaps in a different setting.
I mean, he's already signed up to be in 2019, and I'm committed to being in 2019. So we will meet again on the field of glorious battle. Just kidding.
I hope he remembers you.
I will restore my honor for the House of
Red Fire. He will remember you.
You think you're going to get him next time?
Oh, yeah,
you want to turn this into a feud? That would go against all the principles.
No. I'm absolutely 100% kidding. I mean, he's very responsive on social media. I would long before publicly redressing him, long before that I would address him, you know, either on Twitter or something, like say, hey, man, I'd love to talk about our interaction and post a link or something like that, just something non-inflammatory. Because, like, that's the other thing is, like, when Janeway finds out that Harry Kim is sleeping around with an alien woman, she doesn't dress him down in front of the crew. She takes him aside into the ready room and has a conversation and says, hey, man, this has consequences and impacts, and you need to be freaking responsible, and you need to stop this. So, I mean, and I'm not saying that we should 100% live our lives by what Starfleet officers do on this fictional TV show. I'm just saying there's something there there's a wellspring to be tapped that is really beautiful and powerful.
Well, thanks for sharing. This has been an incredible privilege to hear.
I think we're
about out of time.
Yeah, yeah. I'll just put a pointer towards non-sexy airport voice. Be much more entertaining if they had gotten, you know, some sort of a sexy airport voice, and we'd all be like, oh, it's so fun to listen to. It's so calming, like the Enterprise computer. But, yeah, I want to thank you guys. I know this is mostly Captain Picard giving a speech, but you're very generous listeners, not just you, my co-hosts, but you are actual listeners. And, Richard, my request is that you put this up as soon as possible. STLV 2018 in the Raw with Lewis Brantmeyer.
Yep.
Jeffrey Strell and Tyler Brantmeyer, so that our people can see it, because we got new subscribers who are looking and waiting for being able to hear from us about episodes and other stuff. I highly recommend, as I said, comment, like, subscribe on the video. You know, my friend on Facebook is Lewis Brantmeyer, spelled LouisBrantmeyer, to get quick and easy access to these live streams we were making reference to. Without having to wait for them to drop on YouTube. And, thank you so much for listening. And we're looking forward to another podcast next week where we will go into far more detail when I've had more time to talk about and to digest and process these experiences. Tyler, I love you. Richard, I'm grateful for you. Remind me to tell you about Ethan Phillips' stand-up comedy routine. Jeffrey Combs, Max Grodinchik, Vaughn Armstrong, and Casey Biggs's Star Trek Rat Pack band. That was the very end of the convention. But that'll just be a teaser for next time. Guys,
ooh,
and ladies and gentlemen, have a good night. Thank you for listening. This has been Clever Orbit, Star Trek Las Vegas 2018 convention in the Raw.